Hi, I'm Torben Janssen from thoughtsonjava.org. In this video, I will talk about 5 JPA features that are much easier to use with Spring Data JPA. But before we start, if this is your first time here and you want to learn how to create your entity mappings with ease, build incredible efficient persistence layers with Paginate and all types of other Java persistence related stuff, start now by subscribing and clicking the bell so you don't miss anything. Ease of use is one of the most often stated benefits of Spring Data JPA over plain JPA. And as long as your persistence code doesn't get complex and you follow the few simple rules, I agree with that. Spring Data JPA not only integrates JPA in your Spring stack, but it also makes using several features much easier. Here are 5 examples that are used in most applications. JPQL is JPA's query language, which enables you to define your query based on your domain instead of the table model. That requires 3 steps. You need to define and instantiate the query, set all bind parameter values, and execute the query. Depending on the complexity of your query, you can skip most or even all of these steps with Spring Data JPA. If your query isn't complicated and doesn't use more than 2 bind parameters, I recommend you use the derived query feature. Spring Data then generates the query based on the name of your repository method and executes it. You then don't need to write any JPA or persistence-related code. Here you can see 2 examples. When you call the findByFirstName method, Spring Data JPA generates a JPQL query that selects all author entities with a given first name. And the findByBooksTitle method returns all author entities who have written a book with a given title. As you can see, defining and executing a basic query gets incredibly easy. And you can also order your query results, use pagination, and create more complex expressions for your WHERE clause. I explained all of that in more details in my guide to derived queries with Spring Data JPA. You will find a link to it in the description below, or you check it out here. As comfortable as this feature is, sooner or later your query gets too complex to express it in a method name. You can then annotate your repository method with a query annotation. Within the annotation, you can specify your JPQL query. You also need to provide a method parameter for each bind parameter used in the query. When you call that method, Spring Data JPA uses the provided statement to instantiate a query, sets the bind parameter values, and maps the results. This prevents you from writing lots of boilerplate code. As I explained in an earlier article, DTO projections provide much better performance than entity projections. So whenever you implement a read-only operation, you should prefer them over entities. If you want to use DTO projections with plain JPA or Paginate, you need to implement a DTO class with a constructor that expects all attributes as parameters. In your JPQL or criteria query, you can then use a constructor expression that references the constructor of your DTO class. This tells your persistence provider to call the constructor for each record in the result set and to return the created objects. Spring Data JPA can handle most of these tasks for you. You just need to define an interface and use it as the return type of your repository method. Spring Data JPA then takes care of the rest. Similar to SQL, you can decide to fetch only a subset of your query results with JPA. You can do that by calling the setMaxResults and setFirstResult methods on the query interface. When your user steps from page to page, you need to calculate the value you provide to the setFirstResult method for each page. Spring Data JPA's pageable interface makes that a little bit easier. You can add it as a parameter to your repository method to activate pagination for your query. When you instantiate a new pageable object, you just need to define which page you want to get and how many records are on a page. Spring Data JPA then calculates the correct limit and offset values for you. An entity graph provides an easy and reusable way to initialize required entity associations within your query. Instead of executing an additional query for each entity association, which is known as the N+1 select issue, Paginate then gets all required information with just one query. Defining and using such a graph with JPA isn't complicated, but it requires multiple steps. You first need to use a named entity graph annotation or the entity graph API to define the graph. In the second step, you need to instantiate the graph and add it to your query. Spring Data JPA makes this a little bit easier. When you annotate your repository method with addEntityGraph, you can reference an existing named entity graph by setting its name as the value attribute. Or you can define an ad hoc graph using the attribute paths attribute of the entity graph annotation. JPA provides two ways to call a stored procedure. You can use a name stored procedure query annotation to define your stored procedure call at build time. And if you want to create an ad hoc stored procedure call, you can use the stored procedure query API. Spring Data JPA makes calling a named stored procedure query very easy. With plain JPA, you need to instantiate the query, set the bind parameter values, and execute the query. Almost all of that is very repetitive boilerplate code. Similar to the previously shown JPQL queries, Spring Data JPA takes care of the boilerplate code. And you just need to annotate your repository method with a procedure annotation and provide method parameters with the same names as your bind parameters. When you call the repository method, Spring Data JPA uses this information to instantiate the named.procedure query, set the bind parameter values, execute the query, and return the result. The JPA specification defines most of the features provided by Spring Data JPA. On top of that, Spring Data JPA adds several usability features so that you can focus on your business instead of your persistence code. As you have seen in this video, JPA requires a lot of repetitive boilerplate code to execute a query, implement custom projections, and define query-specific association fetching. Spring Data JPA takes care of that. You just need to add an annotation, and Spring Data JPA provides the boilerplate code. Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Hibernate, you should join the free Thoughts on Java library. It gives you free access to a cheat sheet for this video, several ebooks about JPA and Hibernate, and a video course. I'll add the link to it to the video description below. And if you liked today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!